we are going back on our VLAN journey. This time we will also venture on a little side quest where we understand L2MTU. The main topic is QinQ, a technique that was officially introduced by an amendment to the VLAN standard, and it extends the functionality of devices by increasing the maximum possible number of VLANs, as well as allowing us to categorize and group them. Previously, we learned how VLAN tagging works and we examined the VLAN header in detail. The header, as defined by the 802.1Q standard, begins with 2 bytes that are essentially a special kind of ether type that tells the equipment that the next 2 bytes are also data about the VLAN. The regular ether type is not considered and is simply transported along with the payload. What this means is that the next ether type might as well be the beginning of another VLAN tag. The result would be nested VLANs, and the number of virtual LANs that can be addressed increases exponentially. So with 2 tags, the theoretical maximum is 4096 squared if we count the reserved tags. The problem here is that each tag we add increases the Ethernet frame size. By the IEEE, Institute of Electrical and Electronics Engineers standards, the maximum Ethernet frame was originally set to 1,518 bytes. Out of that, 1,500 bytes is the maximum IP payload, and 18 bytes are what encapsulated in Ethernet. 12 bytes are for the Ethernet header, 2 bytes for ether type, and another 4 bytes are for the footer. Over time, some exceptions have been introduced that allow us to add additional layer 2 headers and therefore exceed the original frame size in predictable ways. One of those headers is the VLAN tag that increases the frame size by 4 bytes. So if we add more than one VLAN header without reducing the 1500 byte IP payload, we are increasing the frame size in an unusual way. The IEEE recognized that there is a legitimate use for 2 VLAN tags, and now the amendment 802.1AD allows adding a second VLAN header. A frame with the maximum payload with 2 VLAN headers would add up to exactly 1,526 bytes. Furthermore, an additional ether type, or TPID, in the context of VLANs was introduced. So now we have a new type identified by the bytes 88A8, besides the old 8100. This just means that now there are 2 types of VLAN, and the new one is intended for service providers. A provider could take the tag traffic from a client's trunk port and encapsulate it with its own service tag for further transportation. Now here I need to warn you that when it comes to MikroTik ecosystem, there are a couple of points of confusion that I would like to clarify. In RouterOS, we have this value called L2MTU, and it sounds like it might be referring explicitly to the Ethernet payload or perhaps to the Ethernet frame size, but it does not. The IEEE standards are one thing, but at the end of the day, the equipment has to work with its limited resources, and every additional byte that has to be processed could have an impact on overall performance. So L2MTU is a value that helps us with optimizing system resources at a very low level. It resembles a maximum number of bytes that we will reserve for the Ethernet payload, MTU, along with the VLAN headers and other layer 2 headers such as MPLS, VPLS, and MaxSec headers. If we take the QinQ example, where we have a frame 1,526 bytes in size, then the L2MTU we require to process that is 1,508. It is the MTU plus 2 VLAN tags, or another way to look at it, the difference between L2MTU and the actual Ethernet frame size is the 18 bytes that I talked about before. If you allow me to explore this MTU tangent a little further, we can take another perspective. Look at the Ethernet frame, the way it looks on the wire. I have here a VLAN and an MPLS header to mix things up. But we are not limited to 2 headers. I just want the picture to fit the screen. Looking at this, we can respect that the size of the whole thing is going to affect the data transfer speed, as each byte takes a fraction of a second to transmit. And that fraction depends on the link speed, of course. You could in fact use this wire byte size to work out how many packets you could get through a given link, and then translate that to a theoretical maximum data transfer speed that you could potentially achieve with some speed test utility. Now, similar to the transmission on the wire, the CPU of your router has to read and write most of those bytes to its RAM, which is by order of magnitude faster, but it is additional work for the system and it does take up memory. Unless, of course, you are using a hardware offloaded bridge, then the switch chip will do all the work and RAM will be spared. So what do we have to store in memory? The preamble and the interframe gap are actually part of layer 1 in wired connections, and they get discarded automatically. Over a different medium such as wireless, there will be different components in place. But whatever the case, we don't care about those at this stage. Then there is the 4-byte large frame check sequence at the end of the Ethernet frame. It is an integral part of the Ethernet frame, but from the perspective of system resource management, it is not, because that part is added and removed automatically when the frame is leaving and arriving at a destination. So we can ignore that as well, and what is left is the actual data that has to be stored in memory. If we then remove the elements that have fixed size that will never change, the leftovers are what make up the L2MTU of this frame. In reality, there is additional data that will be stored and even more that will be reserved, but it is largely affected by the L2MTU that you have set in your interfaces. An interesting quirk of this system is that if you set the L2MTU very high on one interface, all other interfaces will also start to use more RAM, regardless of their L2MTU. That is not a bug, but rather a feature that allows our devices to use FastPath. So when you need to go above the default L2MTU on one interface, you might as well do it on all of them. A little inside tip. The default value is set so it fits a given buffer of memory, and if you are going to increase it even just by a couple of bytes, the buffer will get doubled in size, so you might as well double the default L2MTU if it is not enough. There shouldn't be much difference in resource consumption as compared to adding just a couple of bytes. In routerized, the L2MTU parameter also functions like a maximum cap of your MTU. Normally, the L2MTU is large enough by default to incorporate the typical 1500 byte payload along with several layer 2 headers. Most likely, you won't need it larger unless you are looking to do jumbo frames that can carry payloads as large as 9000 bytes and sometimes even more. Just know that it can affect the performance of your system, particularly low-end devices. Okay, back to the main topic. The most simple way to demonstrate QinQ in action will be virtually, as we get a nice overview of our topology. I have 6 routers here. The 2 in the middle represent a service provider, and their task is to connect different clients that are on opposite sides. The clients need a layer 2 connection, but the top left and top right should not be in the same broadcast domain as the bottom devices, and in fact the configurations of the devices in the corners have some symmetry. They all have 2 VLAN interfaces, VLAN 10 and VLAN 20, but then the devices in the left corners have the exact same IP addresses for those VLANs, and the same goes for the devices on the right side. The provider devices in the middle currently have simple bridges without any VLAN configuration going on, so if I look at the neighbors on one of the client devices, I can see that there are multiple entries for the same IPs. The 4 devices can reach each other directly over layer 2, but there is an address conflict on layer 3. We need to fix this by isolating the top from the bottom. Let's set up QinQ using the regular VLAN tag and reusing the same VLAN IDs 10 and 20. Enable VLAN filtering. On the port section, set the PVIDs along with this additional parameter tag stacking to yes. What tag stacking does, it simply tells the bridge to add tags on top of one another. If a tagged frame enters an access port, instead of reading the existing VLAN tag, it will act as if it is untagged and encapsulate it with another outer tag if necessary. Further, on the VLAN section, we need to specify the tagged ports for both VLANs. Then do the same for the other provider device. A And after the neighbor entries have been updated, you can see that there are no longer multiple entries with the same IPs. We have received the neighbor discovery frame from the directly connected provider device, but the only MAC address that we could communicate with is the right top device. If I try to ping it, it works. We can verify what is going on using Wireshark on the link between the provider equipment. The ping packets have two VLAN tags if you look at the bytes closely. You can see the 8100 ether type in the byte view, and the other tag has the same 8100 before it. We have successfully done QinQ using what are now considered customer tags, but mistakes could happen and our equipment would have no way to differentiate between who tagged what. For example, if we accidentally disabled VLAN filtering on one of the provider devices, the other one would process customer tag traffic as if it is provider tagged. It would be a good idea to make use of the new 802.1ad service tag. If we look at the properties of our bridge, we can see that there is an ether type attribute. From CLI, it might be unclear what it does, but it is a VLAN setting, and if you look at the options, there are only three ether types available. From the GUI, it is more self-explanatory as the ether type setting only shows up once you enabled VLAN filtering. The options are the regular 8100 tag, which could be referred to as the customer tag, the new service tag 8888, and there is also 9100, which is an alternative unofficial ether type for VLANs that people sometimes like to use as well. Just note that the service tag and the 9100 tag are not supported by all switch chips, so you should check the documentation if you are unsure whether your device can make use of them. After setting both provider devices to the service tag, I can now run ping again and then check what changed on Wireshark. Indeed, we can see there is the new ether type on the outer VLAN tag. But with this type of tag, we don't really have to use tag stacking. Just to prove the point, I can quickly disable it on the access ports of both bridges. And when I check the Wireshark as before, there are still two VLAN tags. The trick here is that the bridge is expecting only one kind of VLAN tag, or in other words, one kind of ether type. When it receives a different ether type than the one in the bridge setting, it is simply ignored and another tag can be added if needed. If a frame with the same tag type is received, it will be recognized as already tagged and get either dropped or forwarded to the correct VLAN. That is where tag stacking can be used to ignore the existing one. Since we are using two different kinds of tags, I can update my labels a little bit. You might see these types of labels in our documentation and elsewhere when talking about service tags. CVID stands for Customer VLAN ID and SVID stands for Service VLAN ID. So this might be a little bit better representation of what is going on here. Anyhow, we now understand how to do multiple layers of VLAN tags using VLAN filtering, which is only used when frames are going through a bridge. If we want more than two tags, we could create VLAN filtered bridges on the devices in the corners. But we still have the regular VLAN interface method available, which is also capable of QinQ. In fact, we can use them to create as many tag layers as we like. The only limitation is our L2MTU. But I'll have to show you that a moment later on a real device because there is no L2MTU on CHRs. On our current setup, I can go to the Interface VLAN section and add another VLAN with the existing VLAN 10 as a parent interface. Also, we need to add an IP address, and then of course we need to do that on the other side as well. Now when I ping the IP address of the newly added interface and we check Wireshark, we should find that we are now doing triple tagged frames. One outer service tag and two customer tags on the inside. Okay, so there is only MTU and no L2MTU in CHRs because the virtual routers don't have direct control over any hardware. So for comparison, here is a physical device. There is VLAN 10 and we can create a nested VLAN 30. We can go in further and create VLAN 40 as well. Then when we look at the interface section, we can see that with each nested VLAN that we create, the L2MTU is decreased by 4 bytes. Theoretically, if we kept going, our L2MTU would go under 1500 and eventually so would our MTU, resulting in unwanted fragmentation. Not all devices have the default L2MTU as high as in this example, so it is something to keep in mind when working with VLANs and other layer 2 headers. In some cases, you might need to bump up the L2MTU of the physical parent interface. To wrap up the QinQ topic, I need to show you one more thing. We can use the service tag with VLAN interfaces as well. And since they cannot be hardware offloaded, the switch chip does not matter. We can add a service tag in this manner using any router's device. I will use the VLAN 30 as the parent interface and create VLAN 40. I just need to set the use service tag to yes. Then I will also need to add an IP address and then proceed to do the same on the other device. Normally, you would use the service tag on the most outer VLAN header, as that is what the 802.1ad amendment specifies. But this is RouteOS where we can do whatever we want. Let's check our frames now. Indeed, our outer tag is still the service tag, and our newly created inner tag is also a service tag. Two layers of regular tags are in the middle of this VLAN sandwich. Everything is working correctly, and we aren't even using the tag stacking option. Again, that feature is only necessary if you want the two outermost tags to be of the same kind. If we enable it now, it wouldn't change anything. That is the QinQ topic covered as in-depth as I could. If I have missed anything or you have requests for VLAN-specific topics, let me know in the comments. Take care, and I will see you in the next one.